from Zinman, Parham, which I will refer to as WZP, cites an initial debt collection letter to Mr. Hernandez.
Let me just make sure we have the time done correctly. Did you want to have 5 minutes? How is this working? I'm sorry.
5 minutes. I'll take 2 for rebuttal. I'll stop at 8.
And you'll keep the time for her? Is that how you're planning to do it? Okay.
WCP sent an initial debt collection letter to Mr. Hernandez. That debt collection letter included an incorrect version of disclosures required by the FDCPA. Before the district court, WCP didn't argue that he complied with the FDCPA in the sense that the disclosures were proper. Rather, WCP said because a previous debt collector had already communicated with Mr. Hernandez, it simply wasn't required to provide disclosures in the first place. In other words, WCP argued no harm, no foul. The problem with that argument is that the disclosures were required and that it's a violation of the FDCPA not to provide them. From the outset, Congress enacted the FDCPA to eliminate a problem of debt collectors dunning incorrect individuals or collecting debts that consumers had already paid. Section 1692GA provides that debt collectors must provide certain disclosures to consumers with their initial communication or within 5 days thereof. Now, those disclosures provide rights to a consumer. They allow a consumer to dispute the validity of a debt or to say, please verify this debt, or to request the name and address of the original creditor. And the most natural reading of subsection 1692GA is that it applies to all debt collectors. All debt collectors that communicate with the consumer have to provide the consumer with these disclosures and the according rights that come along with them. The technical reading of section 1692GA confirms the same. But let's pretend for a minute that the natural reading is in question. Let's say it's open to interpretation. While the FTC, the Federal Trade Commission, was charged with enforcing the FDCPA, it seemed to have put an end to that discussion. The FTC specifically said, where we have debt collectors that send debt collection letters to consumers, even if a previous debt collector or a creditor, for that matter, sent the disclosures at issue, the subsequent debt collector has to send those disclosures. So that's pretty clear. But now let's pretend for a minute that the FTC's guidance has no weight. It certainly does.
Would you say it has, will you give it Skidmore deference?
Yes, I think that it is, this court has deferred to the FTC. It's a reasonable interpretation. It complies with, or is in accord with, the plain language and the policy underlying the act. So yes, I think there's
some. But we're under Skidmore, not Chevron here, right? If it needs to be considered at all, we only get to this issue if the language is ambiguous, right?
That's right. So my position is the language is clear. There isn't any consideration necessary. But assume, as district courts obviously see, there's some room for interpretation. So the FTC guidance should be considered. The CFPB guidance should be considered. You'll hear about that in a moment. But let's forget all that. Let's move one step further. Let's say there's no FTC guidance. There's no CFPB guidance. Yet the FDCPA is a liberal statute, a remedial statute to be construed liberally in favor of consumers. It means that if there is an open question, that question has to be decided in favor of the consumer, not the debt collector. So we've got the plain language. We have the FTC, we have the CAPB, and then forgetting all that, we have the standard against which we have to work, which favors consumers. But that's not all. We have to look at the policy. So if this court accepts WCP's position, it would effectively read out of existence the FDCPA's section 1692GA. It would open a loophole, meaning the consumers would dispute the debt or request verification of the debt, a subsequent debt. So the original debt collector could simply say, I'm not going to comply with that, because they don't have to. They could pass the debt along to a subsequent debt collector who could then collect the debt free and clear of ever complying with section 1692GA or having provided the disclosures and rights that it must have. I see that my time is coming to a close quickly. I will afford the CFPB some time in reserve.
That sounds great. Thank you. Good morning, and may it please the Court. I'm Kristen Bateman for the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau. I will pick up where Mr. Radville left off and explain to the Court how the district
district court's interpretation in this case both misunderstood the statutory text and can't be reconciled with the provision's purposes. First, looking at that text, this provision very clearly applies to, quote, a debt collector. A, of course, is a generalizing word. It means any. It doesn't mean some specific debt collector. Now, the district court in WZP attempt to narrow that, and they do that by focusing on the words, the initial communication. The reasoning there is flawed. They say that because the initial communication is singular, that means there must be only one single initial communication, the very first communication ever sent about the debt. And that's not right because, of course, each debt collector has a single initial communication about a debt, and if you look to those words in context, it's clear that the best understanding of the provision is that it's referring to the initial communication of each debt collector, and that it's making each debt collector responsible for its own initial communications with
one of the things that the agency has explained is that the initial very initial communication from the initial contactor is often from the creditor itself, which wouldn't be bound by the statute at all.
Right.
Do we know if Congress knew that?
Congress certainly knew that. Congress considered whether to cover creditors under the Act, mostly made the choice not to.
And we knew, is there some evidence that Congress knew that the initial communication was often from creditors such that, as you're arguing, this whole provision wouldn't make any sense, really, or wouldn't have any purpose?
I would imagine, yes, I can't point you to a specific part of the legislative history, but, of course, whenever there is debt collection, creditors are almost always the ones who begin trying to do it themselves before they hire outside help to help with that.
We heard earlier that one of the purposes here was to protect against the collection for debts that had already been paid. I had thought it was bigger than that, that it was debts that had already been paid and also debts that actually were owed by someone else with the same name and other kinds of problems. Can you describe a little bit what the various sorts of problems are here?
Sure, there are all sorts of problems. Like Your Honor said, collecting debt from the wrong person, which is particularly common if someone has a common name or has family members with similar names. Collecting amounts that you don't actually owe, and that could be for a whole host of reasons. You never took out the account. You're a victim of identity theft. There are unauthorized charges on the account. They've added interest that wasn't authorized under the agreement. You've already paid the debt. You reached a settlement on the debt. There's a whole host of problems. And an important thing to keep in mind about that, too, is when a debt gets transferred from one debt collector to the next debt collector, these sorts of inaccuracies can get introduced at that point, and there's a very significant risk of that happening because not all of the account information gets transferred. Usually it's just a summary spreadsheet about the basic debt, and this kind of information about settlements, about previous disputes, about payments the consumer may have made to the first debt collector doesn't always get passed along. That's a prevalent and well-documented problem, and that's why it is so important that when that new debt collector begins collecting that debt, that they provide a new opportunity for the consumer to dispute, so that she can raise and resolve these sorts of new issues.
One of the things that the defendants have argued is that concepts of privity could take care of this problem. Can you tell us about whether you think that would work as a solution, and if not, why not?
I don't think it would work as a solution for several reasons. First, it has no basis in the statutory text. Second, as I understand their interpretation of this privity idea, the second debt collector wouldn't have to send this new notice. And that, of course, introduces the problem of consumers not being able to raise these new problems that arise when a debt gets transferred from one debt collector to another. I would also note that this isn't a huge burden on debt collectors. This isn't chilling legitimate debt collection efforts and placing undue burdens on our need to collect debts. Debt collectors can comply with this easily. And in fact, WZP tried to comply and just left out a couple of words. The privity concept, I would urge the court not to read into the statute. Another thing that WZP has said is that there are other provisions of the statute that can take care of this problem. And that's not true. Only 1692G appears to raise and resolve these kinds of problems. So unless the court has any further questions, I will leave the rest of the time for rebuttal.
No questions here.
Thank you, counsel.
Good morning. May it please the court. I'm Victoria Orsi. I represent the defendant and appellee, Williams, Zinman, Parham, in this case. My client is a debt collector, and the appellant and amici would have this court rewrite the plain language of the Fair Debt Collection Practices Act, specifically Section 1692GA, and have this court say that the statute says something that Congress did not say that it says, that each debt collector to communicate with the consumer must, within that debt collector's initial communication, send a depredation letter or verification of the debt and give the consumer notice that they have this 30-day period of time within which to dispute the debt. The statute does not say that, and this court must presume that Congress said what it meant and meant what it says. The language used by Congress in enacting this section is plain and it's unambiguous, and it uses words that this court has interpreted in prior cases to be unambiguous and to be consistently interpreted.
So I think your argument depends on the idea that a debt collector means only one debt collector ever. Do you have a case that says that when Congress says a, it means only one rather than any?
No, that's not our argument, actually. Our argument comes from the specific words of the statute in 1692G, which says within 5 days after the initial communication, there can only be one initial communication.
But if say the statute said within 5 days after the initial communication with a consumer in connection with the collection of any debt collector shall, or each debt collector shall, it seems like really, wouldn't you agree that if it said each debt collector shall, it would mean each one that tried to collect this debt would have to do this in its initial communication?
It said that, I would agree that you can read words into the statute that would make it mean what the...
But so, it, because of that, it seems to me that your issue is that A doesn't mean any or each. A only can mean one individual ever. And I'm not understanding really where you're getting that in our case law or elsewhere.
Where I'm getting that is that you can't read that section without the preceding section in the same sentence, which is within 5 days after the initial communication to this consumer about the debt, a debt collector. That means the debt collector that made the initial communication with the consumer about
the debt. But that's adding. Now you're adding words.
But if Congress wanted it to read the way that appellant wants it to read, Congress could easily have said within 5 days after a debt collector's initial communication with a debtor, or within five...
So you just took the same words and said that they could mean the same, what they are saying it means by just moving these phrases around. I mean, it seems like...
They're not moved around. It says very specifically what it says, and the word the has been defined by this court and is defined in dictionaries as a limiting clause.
Right.
That
each
modifies,
debt collector has to say this with their first initial communication.
No, the modifies initial communication.
Right, so the first communication by that entity has to include this information. How do we know that this sentence only refers to one entity instead of every entity that tries to collect the debt?
This sentence refers to the first communication, and whichever debt collector sent that initial communication, there can only be one initial communication because initial is modified by the, which is a limiting article.
And the second debt collector has the initial communication from that debt collector too, right?
That's not what the statute says.
How do you know that though?
Because we read the language of the statute and we don't read words into it or out of it. We also know that the district court read it very naturally, exactly using the words that are here as they've been interpreted by this court in the past. So, and as they've been interpreted by many other district courts and a few other circuit courts in the past to mean exactly what the language says. I think it's important to address the fact that the request for validation that a consumer might make to a debt collector can come whether they have the notice of this or not. And if a consumer disputes a debt, whether they do it in writing, whether they do it orally, if they say, this is not me, I am the wrong person to be dunned here, or this is not my debt, or I already paid the debt, they are going to exercise those rights. And if they are done...
Well, you could make that argument if the statute didn't exist, right? Didn't Congress pass the statute for a reason?
Yes, it did. And the statute is extremely comprehensive, and it is construed very strictly against debt collection and very liberally in favor of consumers. But in fact, what happens is if I am improperly dunned, whether it's from the initial debt collector that is required to send me this validation, or the second or the third one down the line, who perhaps doesn't send me this validation notice, if I dispute it and I'm done improperly, that debt collector is going to violate many other sections of the Act. So that not giving 30-day successive validation periods over and over every time there's a new collector doesn't diminish the rights that are given to any particular...
That's true. What's the purpose of requiring the first one to give the validation notice?
Because Congress intended to have the initial collection letter, collection communication, followed by this verification or validation period of 30 days.
And on your view, what's the purpose of that?
The purpose of that is to give the consumer, when they get that initial notice, the right that they're told, they're given the right to dispute it within that period of time. And if they do it within a certain time in writing, then the debt collector, that debt collector is going to cease activities until they give validation and verification. But in the event, for example,
on your argument, that's not necessary because all the other provisions of the Act take care of any problem with collecting that.
They do, because if I'm...
Your argument is proves too much or something. I mean, you're arguing this whole section isn't necessary on your reading, so if that's true...
No. My argument isn't that the section isn't necessary. It is necessary. Congress obviously intended a consumer, when they got the initial notice of a debt collection, that there was a debt out there that was due or allegedly due, that they were entitled to this notification in this period of time. Now, keep in mind, during this period of time, it doesn't mean during that 30 days that all debt collection activity has to cease. It just means that if the consumer disputes it in writing, then the debt collector ceases until they give them verification. But in fact, Congress, if they intended to have successive 30-day periods of time every time the debt might be transferred or there would be a different debt collector involved, Congress would have said that, just like it says in other sections of the statute. It talks about the initial communication, whether it's oral or in writing, and subsequent communications. Congress was very specific about what it intended in those sections, and it's specific here in that it does not say that each new debt collector has to send a validation notice. Now, in this particular case, Ms. Hernandez didn't dispute the debt, and the notice that came to her of the debt from my client was not the initial notice to her. It wasn't the initial communication to her about the debt. That came from my client, a law firm's client, another.
How would she know for sure that the communication that the debt your client was communicating about was the same one she'd had the communication about earlier? In fact, she didn't even get the earlier communication here, right?
Well, no.
Or she
actually,
said she didn't.
The district court found under the mailbox rule that the presumption was met in the record that the debt collector, my client's client, actually mailed the letter and it went to the home, the address at which she was.
She said she didn't receive it, though.
What she said specifically was, everything that I got, I gave to my lawyer, and my lawyer doesn't have it, and therefore, I must not have gotten it.
Let's assume she did get it. How would she know for sure that the second communication is about the same debt rather than some other debt or her cousin's debt or something else? How does she know without being able to have this validation right and warning that it's even the same debt?
Well, that information was on the notice that my client sent. The notice that WZP sent to Ms. Hernandez said that who the creditor was, what the amount was. It had the information. What it didn't have is the specific language that the appellant wanted my client to have to put in that letter to, which had already been put in the initial letter to her. It did.
Is there a section of the statute that required it to identify the debt as specifically as you're saying that it did?
I didn't understand your question.
You say that the letter that your client did send very specifically identified the debt. Does the statute require that to have been done, and if so, where?
Yes, because if my client, when it sends the subsequent letter, doesn't identify the name of the creditor or has the wrong amount or sent the letter to the wrong person, they are in violation of other sections of the Act. And the consumer, first of all, can read that and say, that's not the right amount, that's, I don't know this particular creditor, and can dispute the debt and not pay it, and they're able to do that, whether this validation notice is in here or not. Secondly, if the consumer's correct about that, they have the same remedy, besides not paying the debt, that they have, that Ms. Hernandez wants to have in this case, which is a violation of the Act, because it's a violation of so many other parts of the Act to done somebody incorrectly.
What is the burden?
Counsel.
Sorry, go ahead,
Judge Gould. If I can interject one question from my perspective. Is there any federal circuit court that you urge has interpreted Section 1692GA, I think I've got that provision right here, that has interpreted that provision of the FTCPA and held that it, as you argue, it only applies to the first communication by the first collector? Or is there any federal circuit court that's taken the appellant's position? And in other words, I'm trying to find out, is the issue before us an issue of first impression?
It is an issue of first impression. There are no other circuits that have weighed in on this issue one way or the other, except that the Tenth Circuit, in an unpublished decision where their rules say that it's not dispositive, the Tenth Circuit has taken the position that we are urging, that a subsequent debt collector is not required under 1692AG or GA.
That's an unpublished, you said.
Yes, it is.
So there's no precedential decision in any circuit on this issue.
That's correct.
So you're arguing, based on the general principles you've urged about what the meaning is of the word the.
That's exactly correct, Your Honor. What we are urging is that if you read the plain language of the statute as Congress intended it and chosen those words instead of other words, that it means what it says, which is that there is only one initial communication. It is the initial communication. And the debt collector that sent the initial communication has to send out the validation notice within 5 days or with the initial notice.
Very interesting issue. Probably all of you will end up arguing to the Supreme Court someday.
I'm not so sure about that, Your Honor, but I would not, I would rather not have to.
At this point, though, there are district courts, lots of district courts, who have considered this issue, and they're very split, right?
They are split.
So why shouldn't we view the fact that the district courts are so split as an indication that this language is ambiguous and then defer to the agency?
That's an excellent question. If you look at the decisions of the district courts that have either taken the FTC commentary, when it's just commentary, it's not a rule, it's not a regulation, it's not interpretation of those things, it's just commentary, it's not entitled to anything more than respect under Skidmore, it's not entitled to Chevron deference. But if you look at those decisions, you will not see an accompanying analysis of the statute as the district court did in Arizona in this particular case, and a particular parsing of the words and giving those particular words the meaning that this court has given them in its definition, and in cases such as Carlucci, where it specifically says the is a defining and limiting clause, and that is the clause that refers to initial communication in the statute. When perhaps it was that when Congress enacted the act, it maybe wasn't fully aware that this debt collection industry would turn into something that has evolved and to be as large as it is today.
What would be the burden of having each debt collector in its initial communication give this validation notice?
I think that the burden would be greater on the courts than on the debt collectors because you are going to find more. First of all, it would be helpful if they knew one way or the other, which is why we're here.
Then we can clarify that. But if we say that if they all have to do it, then what is that a problem?
What will result from that is a floodgate of additional litigation over whether or not this word is exactly correct and whether writing is in there. There's already a plethora of litigation over what language is acceptable under the GA or the AGGA section because of the issue of overshadowing. So unless we both have a decision and definitive language that all of the courts accept as appropriate and exactly matching what Congress intended, then you're going to have more and more litigation and more FDP violations alleged. You're not going to have greater rights to a creditor because they can always... But they can always seek validation and verification, and they're always going to have the same remedy if they're improperly done. So while Congress may not
have you over your time, does anyone have further questions?
No further questions?
Thank you, counsel.
Thank you, judges.
Your Honor, why this is important, why subsequent debt collectors should be compelled to comply with the section at issue. And I think there's a very big picture, big reason that it's important, because we're not simply talking about disclosures. We're talking about substantive rights. That's because every substantive right afforded by Section 1692G, meaning B, C, D, E, all those rights stem directly from the initial disclosures, meaning these substantive rights exist only during a period of time that begins from the date on which the consumer received the initial disclosure. So if there is no initial disclosure, if the subsequent debt collector does not descend it, those substantive rights found in Section 1692G simply don't exist. And they are more than what the FDCPA encompasses with respect to other provisions. A subsequent debt collector, if WCP is correct, simply doesn't have to stop collecting the debt or verify the debt or answer a consumer's response as the original creditor or original debt collector would do in the face of a request for validation or a statement such as, I was a victim of identity theft, this isn't mine, or I never belonged to Bally Total Fitness, you're collecting a Bally Total Fitness debt, or this is my mother's debt. The subsequent debt collector doesn't have to do anything where the original debt collector would. The subsequent debt collector can blindly continue its efforts, which include, for example, credit reporting, putting on someone's credit, and say, I'm not required to comply with this section, so I'm not going to. They may not, but they certainly don't have to. And that's important. That's a real-world problem, especially considering the FTC's acknowledgement that subsequent debt collectors often have insufficient or inaccurate information about debts. As the opposing counsel stated, the debt market's big. It's really big. $100+ billion debt market. Subsequent debt sales amount for about half of that. So we're looking at $50-some-odd billion worth of debt that is outside the reach of the FDCPA that doesn't have the protections Congress wished to afford it. That can't be what Congress intended. For that reason, for the reasons that the CFPB stated, we respectfully request.